episode number 13. We are here at zPizza Tap Room, home of 520 Sports Talk. Guys, no, I'm kidding. This is the biggest show we've had. We have an incredible series of guests here. I am so proud to have Bill, who had set this up. This weekend, Friday, is the
after Thanksgiving. The
yes,
big game.
Is the Territorial Cup, U of A ASU. Big game for both teams. ASU wins, they become bowl eligible. U of A wins, and we keep the Territorial Cup. So make sure you go out there and see that. We have an amazing line of guests here, all U of A alum who have played on the football team, several who never lost to ASU. And that's a huge deal. So we're going to get into that. If you are on Facebook Live watching us right now, make sure you send your questions along. Producer Andy, Jason, our marketing director, will be sending us the questions as you have them. zPizza and Tap Room has been lucky to grace us with a few gifts for you guys. So as you're watching, make sure to send your questions across. We're going to do some trivia. We're going to be giving away a pair of tickets to zPizza and Tap Room's New Year's Eve party. Dr. JJ Unplug will be performing. There's going to be pizza, wings, and salad buffet included. There's a champagne toast at midnight. It's going from 10 to midnight on New Year's Eve here at zPizza Tap Room in Oro Valley. We are on the corner of La Cañada and Naranja. Make sure to come by and check everyone out. Tonight is the Tap Tuesdays, so Thunder Canyon Brewery's here. Make sure you come down. It's going to be pretty amazing. So, Bill, why don't you go through our guest list here, introduce everyone to who we have, and we'll kind of go from there.
Okay, so what we have, I'm going to go from newest to oldest, I guess.
We don't use that word, oldest.
Exactly.
Youngest
to senior. Yeah.
Youngest to senior.
No, it's not.
We're gonna go over a span of probably two different coaches. We have Syndric Steptoe here. He was a wide receiver, kick returner for the Cats from 2003 to 2006. He has honorable mention All Pac-12 two times. Pac-12 or Pac-10 at that point?
Pac-10.
Yeah. All right. Drafted by the Cleveland in the seventh round. Right. Glad to have you here. Let's start out, Step, with you. What's the what ASU game that you played in? What stands out in your mind the most?
Definitely be the 2004 season when, you know, that was Stoops' first year here, and we ended up beating them on our home turf. You know, it was my true first experience, because my freshman year we played up there, but it was a lot of turmoil going on the team. So in my sophomore year playing them here, looking forward to the next year and actually beating those guys, you know, was something that I would never forget.
All right, that's great. What was the Cats' record against ASU when you went to school?
We were 2-2.
2-2.
Yeah,
okay.
2-2.
And that was all with Coach Stoops.
With Coach Stoops.
All right.
Oh, that's true, because your first season, it was Coach Makovic for the first five games, you said?
Correct.
Okay, and then he was. Were there any interim games?
What's that?
It was Hankowitz.
Hankowitz, okay. Right, yeah. Okay. Okay,
so
wonderful.
It was difficult then, you know, right. But we got through it and came on the other side.
And you were saying earlier that you kind of, you know, you were, I mean, it was your first year, you didn't really know the difference, but were some of the older guys, you know, some of the upperclassmen, how did they handle the transition?
Well, the year prior, they had just had a big brawl on Sparky.
Right.
So I was kind of introduced to that and saying, well, this is how we do things. And then we had one of the alums, I can't remember his name, but he was in our locker room before the game, and he flipped over like three or four Gatorade tables.
Oh, boy.
And so it kind of let me know, okay, it's time to go get it. So let's go get it.
So as a personal moment for you during your games against ASU, what's the one play that you participated in that sticks out the most against ASU?
It was that 2004 season. I think I caught a it was like a 45-yard pass from Richard Kovacek down the middle, you know, up the seam. Didn't go for a touchdown, but it was definitely one of the signature plays in the game that set us up for a score.
That's awesome.
A lot of trash talking, you know, going back and forth into each other's huddles.
You know, we didn't talk too much. At least I didn't. I was running too hard. I was too tired to talk. So I let my play do the talking.
That's right. All right, great. The rest of the fellas here all played under Coach Smith. And I'm going to take just a second here and read you guys something. Coach Smith's daughter, Allie Smith, wanted to be here with us tonight, but she had a another engagement in Texas and stuff. So I asked her to write us something to talk to the Coach Smith players that we have here, and she came back and said, you know, they're going to have their own stories and everything's going to be good and everything like that. But she did put one story, and I even heard you guys talking about it a little bit during one of the ASU games. It says, a few of them may recall the year the U of A was on a winning streak with our away game white uniforms. So my dad had the U of A wearing the white uniforms for our home games. We were ready to play ASU in Tucson, and he let ASU know that we were wearing our white jerseys and they were to wear their home jerseys. ASU showed up wearing their away uniforms, and the ref said that we had to change into our dark uniforms. Of course, my dad was pissed off, and this is not a mistake on ASU's part. I'm sure you guys all know that. So he made sure that we took our time changing jerseys and made ASU sit for over an hour in the locker room until the game started late. We still beat their ass, and because the NCAA from then on made a rule that, for the most part, you have to wear your home jersey in the road. So maybe except for LSU. I don't ever see LSU wear their dark uniforms at home. But you guys want to comment on that?
There you go.
Well, first of all, I want to say I don't remember changing. Do you, Jay?
No.
I don't remember us changing. We stayed in white.
Did
and if
you
go
white?
And if you go watch the video, you'll see that, because the first touchdown was to H-bomb, a little toss when they blitzed, and he took it however many yards down the field. But we didn't change. We stayed in white uniforms.
Nice. I remember that. I was in school, actually, when the streak was going on in the white uniforms, and that was definitely a good season. John?
But what I believe, Julius, was before the game, we told him we're going to wear our white jerseys at home, and they didn't want us wearing our white jerseys at home. And then ASU came down in their dark jerseys. So I'm not sure if pregame did we wear our blue jerseys or not. I can't recall. I don't think we did. I think we heard before the game. But my jersey was never clean. I wore my practice jersey.
Okay.
There's like four or five guys of us that wore practice jerseys, if I recall that right. But we did come out in our whites, and we still kicked their ass, so it didn't matter.
Exactly. Jay, you remember that?
That was the 82 year.
Yes.
Right? That was the 82 season. And ASU had this defense. They had Vernon Maxwell. They had David Fulcher was on that team.
Paul Moyer.
Yeah. They had Mario Montgomery was on. That was a great defense, right? It was college football's version of the 85 Bears 46 defense.
Okay.
They blitzed and blitzed and blitzed, and they just smothered people. And we had a great game plan. Steve Axman put together a great game plan for us, and they did not know how to solve us. Everybody was worried about solving them. Like Julia said, Brian Holland went 92 yards against them, like with a blitz beater pass.
That. He snuck out of the backfield, right?
Brad Anderson went about 70 yards on him,
yeah.
And we had them behind the eight ball from the beginning. And this was the game when all their fans showed up with the roses. They were all holding roses. They were going to the Rose Bowl. They had the roses in their teeth, but they had to beat us. And they just thought it was a sure thing. Like, we're going to take these dudes down. And you know what? The whole jersey thing, that's just gamesmanship. That's just, hey, you know, we're the home team. You're coming to our stadium. You're coming to our field. You're going to play by our rules.
All right. So we thank Allie, if you're watching, we thank you for bringing up that great memory from Coach Smith and stuff, and the guys, I'm sure, enjoyed it too.
I'm gonna toss it over here.
All right, so we're gonna kind of backtrack a little bit. I'm gonna do a little bit of bios on each of you guys. If I get any of this information wrong, please correct me.
So they're gonna tackle you. There's not gonna be correction. They're just gonna tackle you.
That's right. That's right. I don't know what breakaway speed. So, Julius Holt, I think you're the elder statesman of
here.
The.
There you go.
Okay.
Yeah. We're reading some notes. Pardon us. Don't worry about that. Right. Preparation is not one of our strong suits right here.
I got here.
All right.
You played from 80 to 83. You're an inside linebacker, correct? Defensive line. Okay. Two-time consensus right. All-American?
Nope.
Man, we're, Wikipedia is just way off.
We should have been.
That's right. I know that you were Pac-10 three times.
Junior college, All-American, second team.
Okay.
There we go. Defensive lineman of the year.
Uh-huh.
And the Tough Boot Award winner.
The Tough Boot Award winner, that's right. And then you were picked in the draft. Are you the highest player drafted in there?
First of all, Ricky Huntley.
You're thinking about Ricky Huntley.
Okay.
And I know we all look alike, and I wasn't drafted. but it wasn't me. Oh. That was the Huntley brothers. That's I'm the third version of the Huntley brother.
You are one of their brothers.
So what I guess what we're saying is that Wikipedia
is way off.
Is way off. Well, yeah. You know what? If you can add stuff yourself, you know.
That's true. That's
you know,
true.
You trust the source. But Julius, tell us about your time, you know, your experiences against the ASU, your games against ASU, and maybe tell us a little bit about what you're doing now.
Well, you know, I remember the first year I played against Arizona State. Up at ASU, it was raining. It rained really, really hard. And I didn't really understand the importance of the game or what it really meant. It was my first year. But after going through a couple of series of plays and, you know, going back and forth, you know, getting tattooed a little bit and giving a little bit of tattoo, I understood that that game meant a lot. It was important. It was like I got my brothers on my side. They got their brothers on their side. And I'm not going to let nobody hurt my brothers.
And now, who was their coach during that time?
You know what?
Darryl Rogers.
Yeah. Darryl Rogers. Rogers.
But I never forget Coach Smith really having a long conversation with us, you know, about that game and what it meant. What it meant to him, what it meant to the people of Tucson. And, you know, we were just a fearless bunch of guys, man. You know, we always had great defenses back then. You know, our defense was real strong, and our goal was to keep the offense in the game, and we did that. We did that a lot. And Jay and them was talking about when ASU came down here for the Rose Bowl. One of the things I can honestly say that Coach Smith did that weekend, or that for that particular game, he allowed our defense to be open. He allowed us. We blitzed a lot. You know, he freed us up. Because their linemen were big guys, but they were slow guys, so they couldn't really stay in front of us. So that allowed us to do some things, to make them have to do some things different. So it put them under pressure a lot where they were used to running the ball. When we forced them to have to pass the ball, we were very successful doing that. So the ASU game, I mean, it's an interesting a situation to be involved in. And I guess you have to be there, or you have to play in it. Would you agree, Jay?
Absolutely.
And I know that a lot of teams that blitz don't like to be blitzed. Just like in basketball, a lot of teams that press don't want to go against the press. So, kind of like that.
Not at all. And I'm going to tell you, ASU, they blitz. Watching the film on them, you know, even though we were on the defensive side of the ball, we got to see some of their defensive stuff. They blitzed a lot. I mean, it was like every play they were sending somebody. They were quicker. But, you know, like Jay said, Coach Smith put a really good game plan together. And we came out and, you know, we were the spoilers. I mean, you coming down here with tattoos on the side of your face, talking about you going to the Rose Bowl, carrying roses in your teeth. You don't do that.
Right.
And one of the things Coach Smith used to always tell us, you know, if you're in an alley and you got your back against the wall and there's only one way out, you can't go over the wall, you can't go through the wall, you got to go through them. And that was our motto. We're going to go through you because you ain't coming through us.
Right. That's great. Jay, do you want to add something?
Well, in general, in the ASU rivalry, right? It's beyond anything that I've experienced, and I've experienced a lot of different things in my life, conflicts, but it's beyond anything else. It's so different because there's so much passion, but it's beyond that. It's like it's the blood of the state, you know? You're dropping the blood of the state on that field. And you know, like the guys sitting at this table, these are my teammates. We Julius's team started the streak. Julius's senior year started the streak where we went 9-0 against ASU. That's like one of the most proud accomplishments that I hold from my time with Arizona is that I never lost to that school. I never lost a game to them. We had some close ones, but I'll tell you what. When I look at the totality of my career, right, and I look at these guys, I'm looking across the table from David and Jerry, and I got Kai sitting next to me, I got Julius. There's games that I don't remember played with teammates that I'll never forget. It's about us. It's about our boys. It's about, you know, the family that we have. You look at all the things that are going on in this country. You look at all the problems, all the issues. You take a group of guys, right, from all different walks of life, from very affluent lifestyles to guys that came to school that have dirt floors. You got guys that are like well-to-do families, from guys that are from single-parent families or no-parent families, and they come together for a common goal, a common bond, right? So Coach Smith, he was big on goals. He was big on writing your goals down. On our locker room, every year, he had five primary goals. The number one goal, number one every year, was beat ASU. That was so important to him, and it was important to him, and thus it became important to us. You know, we loved him, and it was if it meant that much to him to make that the number one goal of his team, of the team he was coaching, of his career, then we embraced that. It was so important to us to win that game. There was other goals, win the conference championship, you know, all these other things he had, but the number one goal was beat ASU, and that translated and saturated the entire team. It was something that was very, very important to us.
That's right. So we're going to move along a little bit later in the streak, and we got David Adams and Jerry Beasley from Sunnyside. So actually, you guys have been in town a whole long time. So tell us about some of the games that stuck out in your mind, David and Bees.
For me, like to piggyback on what Jay said, you know, I'm 5-0 against them, and that's in itself is a blessing, because when you're that close to somebody in proximity, when you go to Phoenix and everybody's talking about the rivalry and stuff like that, everybody's talking about 2-3, 3-1, things like, but they never bring it up to me because I never lost to them. So they don't talk. They don't talk to me about the game. They'll talk to everybody else, but they don't bring it this way.
That's right.
But, you know, 5-0. The things that I remember about my senior year was probably, we do a radio conference thing with the other team. And the coach said, well, you guys got a good offense, and Adams is pretty good. So that was a big mistake. He's pretty good. But nobody gets 100 yards against us. That was a mistake in itself.
Right.
Because he was right. I didn't have 100 yards. I had like 150. So that was something that was nice to ram down their throats. But for me, to whoop somebody that you may see, that's beauty in itself. Because, you know, we beat Washington once, but I'm never going to run into those guys again.
Right.
There's a chance I can run into somebody from ASU.
Sure.
And they never want to talk about it. Because my thing, regardless of what happens now, it's nice if U of A wins. But when ASU pulls out a victory, they always want to talk trash. But I said, listen, I'm 5-0. You can't bring that to me. And that's what I've always liked about it. The teammates that you make during college is something that really lasts a lifetime, because we've all been through the exact same stuff together. Good, bad, or ugly, we've been through it together, and we stuck together. And when something happens to your teammates' family, it's devastating to you. Our quarterback, Al Virginia's mother, passed away a few months ago. It hurt.
But, you know, we did lose. So then at the end of the season, it came down to what decision I wanted to make as far as going to the U of A, and ASU was, you know, recruiting me real hard, and they were really coming after me as well as U of A. But, you know, I grew up as a Wildcat fan. It was in my blood. It was just basically who I was. And I just couldn't really see myself going up north when I was a U of A fan all my life. So, it was a pretty easy decision when it came down to it, really, with me.
And what game in your career stood out against ASU the most?
Well, I'm going to echo what Jay said, is, you know, with ASU, Coach Smith this was our bowl game. This is like a bowl game. This is the biggest game of the season. So Coach Smith left. He went to USC, and I played a year under Coach Tomey.
Okay.
And after Coach Tomey came in, you know, it was a battle down there up in ASU, and we tied him. So Julius started the streak, and we tied him. Well, they tied us, actually, to save their season there. And but that was like a win to us because we still didn't lose to ASU.
Now, did Coach Tomey put the same emphasis on that game as Coach Smith?
Yeah, I think he did. He actually did because he knew that was a big game. They kind of drilled that in the at least Coach Tomey, because I played under him, and they drilled that into him. He drilled it into us that we needed to, you know, we need to be real competitive in this game and win this game. So that was a tough game, and we wanted to win, but we didn't lose, and that's what makes the difference there. So we still had that streak going that we never lost the ASU, and I can say I've never lost the ASU.
That's what important. I'd like to hear.
That's right.
We're gonna stand by for just a second. We got to go over some of our sponsors that make this show possible. As long as we've been on the air now for a little bit over 3 months, and we appreciate the viewers that you guys have made us what we are. Continue to watch us. Check out the Facebook page, and I believe the website will be up this week. Correct?
Yeah. Website will be up. Just we've had such overwhelming response. With new sponsors, I want to make sure we're doing it right, you know, get the right logos, get everything on there done right. We don't want to give you a bad product and everything. Obviously, we care about the quality of the show, which is why we're bringing all these incredible guests. So let's go over, obviously, zPizza and Tap Room, one of our wonderful sponsors are hosting us. They are the official home of 520 Sports Talk. So once a month, we're going to have a remote broadcast. It'll be right here at zPizza and Tap Room. Also, we want to thank Nova Home Loans, Chris Lawler, for sponsoring us. He sponsors the Andy Taylor Studio. Additionally, Surreal Skin by Sharon Skincare. We also have Classic Cuts Barbershop at Ina and Thornydale. It is Oasis Air Conditioning and Heating, or Heating and Air Conditioning. It's one of the two, but get them both done, right? Okay. Additionally, Michas on 4th Avenue, great Mexican food. And is there anyone forgetting? I think I got all of them.
I think you did get all of them.
All right. Tucson A-List. Andy, what would we do without you? Thank you so much. Tucson A-List is definitely one of our great partners here. We cannot thank Tucson A-List enough. They're great, and they give us a lot of, you know, great connections with a lot of the local business community. So if you're looking for a good local service provider, Tucson A-List is the place to go. Okay, we cleared all that sponsorship stuff, so I want to do this right now. If you are watching the live broadcast right now, we want you to... the first and second person to send comments over right now, one of you will win two passes to New Year's Eve right here at zPizza and Tap Room. So I'll show you that right here. zPizza and Tap Room, it's New Year's Eve. They're going to have a DJ. Dr. JJ Unplug will be performing. They're going to have pizza, wings, salad buffet included, and a champagne toast at midnight. So we have a pair of tickets for you to give away here. And also, we have zPizza shirt. They give a shiitake.
That's right.
Right there.
And so since this is a family show, that's all we can say about that.
Yeah, they
can't beat that.
Yeah. So that's about as much as we're gonna be able to swear. Gonna turn it around. Got zPizza right here. So thank you so much. So the next two people that send us comments and likes on the Facebook page, we will go ahead and find you and we will connect with you and get you those. Additionally, the new 520 Sports Talk shirts are out. They're for sale, $15. We actually have the gentleman sign a few, so we have those available as well for a little bit more. So make sure you check in with us on that. So
that makes a great Christmas present, stocking stuffer. So especially if you can get one with the Arizona alumni football players signed on it, that's something you can hang in your bar at home or go to work and show off or whatever the case is.
So we're going to move right now to this gentleman here on my left. And, guys, if you wouldn't mind sending a microphone on down here.
Go ahead and send your questions in, guys, so we can start asking the players on the show what you'd like to know about tonight's episode.
So, yeah, send the questions in, comments and everything like that. We'll stock them up, and then we will be able to send them over to you. So to my left here is John Kaiser, linebacker, played for the U of A from 1981 to 1984. Is that right? I mean, if Bill's pulling from Wikipedia, I'm going to have to check the source now. So
I'm going to make some phone calls tomorrow.
First of all, I'm not Ricky Henry, so I know that, right, Julius?
He was much better than I was, that's for sure.
Well, you did introduce yourself as Ricky Hunley, so I was only told later. No. So I have a few statistics here. I have you were on the Pac-10's all-time badass team.
Well, I picked that team.
All right.
Yeah, so that's why I'm on it. Yeah.
It's kind of like a John Madden team or something.
Absolutely.
So I have as the linebacker core were the Hunley brothers, yourself.
And Julius Holt.
The elder statesman.
Was it Steve Bodway?
Steve Bodway was...
Bodway.
Yep.
That was our linebacking crew. The two Hunleys. And probably one of the best ones we all forgot about was Glenn Perkins.
Glenn Perkins
was maybe one of our best ones if he didn't have a knee injury. He was legit. We all just know that because
What game sticks out in your mind during this series?
Well, besides beating ASU twice, I mean, that's always the first memory of all time. And then, you know, Jay Dobb and Julius will tell you that. Bees and David were freshmen. I'm not sure. Were you guys at Notre Dame? Yeah, if David was on the team, we probably would have won the first quarter. Yes, Julie. Yeah, they were, but playing at Notre Dame, beating Notre Dame in South Bend, they're like ranked fourth in the nation, and that's an unbelievable, great memory. But for that being, it is what it is. Beating ASU, going undefeated, a better feeling. And I'm asked this question all the time. I'm an old fart. I'm an old timer. And they go, "What do you miss about the game?" I go, "You know what I miss about the game? Game day and my brothers in the locker room. All four of these guys right here, my brothers in the locker room. That's what you miss. You miss the brotherhood. You miss game day. But, boy, nothing like game day and beating ASU."
Exactly.
Let me tell you about Kaiser. He was a technician. He was a great linebacker.
Yes, he was.
So we don't understand. People don't understand about U of A. U of A had a great linebacker core. Kaiser, Bodway, the Hunleys, Ricky, Lamont. Then people ask me, "Well, why didn't you go to ASU?"
Byron Evans.
Byron. And we had a great core linebackers. You know, Byron, all-sensitive All-American, Ricky. You know, it was a great core linebackers there. And John Kaiser, you know, he was a technician at that outside linebacker position.
I trained him well when I was young, didn't I? I fooled him early.
Yeah, but I remember seeing you blow up those running backs coming out of the flat. So yeah.
I appreciate that. But you know what? It's like, you know, our basketball team's known as Point Guard U. I really think U of A football should be known, starting from Ricky Hunley and Perk, you know, Bodway.
Lance Briggs.
I mean, I still believe one of the greatest all-time linebackers of all time, who's not respected enough in U of A history, is Byron Evans.
I think he's
one of the greatest of all times. NFL and college.
Yeah, he played for the Eagles for years.
But U of A should be known as linebacker U. We've had bees after me. It's on and on and on and on. I know Jay Dobb had great hands and did his things, but you know what we got? You and Vance Johnson, John Horton.
Both better than me. I watched them make some great plays.
Yeah, but
I had the best seat in the house to watch him do it.
Yeah, but you like to go over the middle and just get clobbered.
Best hands I ever saw was Jay Dobbins.
Yes.
Let me say something real quick. Now, I'm going to tell you something, not because Jay and I are real close, but I tell you one of the things, he said those guys were better than him. There's a difference. You know, you can be talented, but there's some other things that you got to, when you watch people make themselves better. I remember I used to go into McHale Center, and we'd be leaving. Jay and Brad Anderson being there in the dark catching balls. And I'm like, they had the ball connected to a wall, and they in the dark catching footballs. And when you watch these guys run routes, they never cheated on a route. You know, they did the little things. You know, so yeah, you can be talented, but if you're not being a technician, like Jerry said about Kaiser, you know, you're gonna have issues when you get up there against somebody that's more technically sound than you are. Mm-hmm. And I'm gonna tell you this too. I take credit for Ricky Hunley and Lamont Hunley and Glenn Perkins and all them guys being All-Americans and all Pac-10 players, Pace. Because my job as a defensive lineman playing the five technique was not to allow any offensive lineman to get up on them. And Coach Smith reminded me of that every day in practice, every day in meetings.
You and Dave Wood.
Joe Drake. I mean,
God bless Joe Drake.
John Brothaw. John Brothaw was probably one of our smallest defensive linemen. But I'm going to tell you, you talk about no quit, a guy with heart. That guy, man, he was unbelievable. You know, and I don't want to get off on a tangent, but that's one of the things I try to share with my kid right now, is that you got to be ready every game. You know, you got to make your mind up. You got to ask yourself that big question. You know, what do you want to do? You know, because the sky's the limit. If you put in the work and you work hard at it, you know, and I think that's going to happen in the future. I mean, Jay Dobyns coached my son over in South Point. Like we talked about earlier about that camaraderie and having great friends. So we're all brothers, man, and we take care of each other.
Hey, Julius, can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Because you've been in this rivalry all your life.
Right.
Now your son's a Wildcat. How's it feel to him being part of this tradition? And what does it mean to him compared to what it meant to you?
Well, that's interesting because him and I, you know, as a little kid, you know, he's never really liked Arizona State. I think he understands.
Why should he?
Oh, he shouldn't. My daughter either. And he understands what this game is all about. Even though he's red-shirting this year, you know, just talked to him a couple of nights ago, and he says, Dad, I don't care what else happens the rest of the year. The goal is to beat Arizona State. He said, I know some people might not like the fact that I'm saying that, but that's our season right there because we can stop them from going to a bowl game, and it'll start something for me. Like David said, 5 years of not losing to him, that'll be an awesome feat for a young kid to come in and say, I've never lost to you in 5 years. And I hope he gets that opportunity when the time comes. But, you know, I'm a proud dad, you know. And you guys have been very influential in my son's life as well. So I just want to leave it at that and say thank you to everybody and beat the shit out of her. Can I say that?
You can say it on Facebook.
Welcome to Facebook. That's why we're not on the air, right? Hey.
I don't care for Arizona State at all, period. Don't care for them. So to beat them would be so satisfying and gratifying for me.
That's all. So we have a lot of questions for you guys that are coming through on Facebook, so I don't want to interrupt, but I have so many questions here that are coming through. Wow, there's a lot. So we'll just start here.
Bring them on.
We'll just kind of go all the way around. Jump in whenever you have. Grab a microphone and jump in. So here we go. Okay, so the first question is, do you guys still follow U of A football? And if so, what advice do you give to the team for this week?
Try and get me some eligibility so you can win. That's my advice.
All right, well, Rich Rod is a viewer of our show. So, Coach, if you're watching, David Adams.
I think he's got a red shirt left.
I would say special teams. Defense. We need to get the U of A back to playing tough defense, like John Kaiser said. Kaiser said, you know, it's a U of A linebacker. You know, we had Byron was the hardest linebacker I ever seen, and that's what we need to hitting linebacker I've seen in my life, and we need to get back to that.
You know, I get to ask this question all the time. You know, what do coaches say before a game? And you know, I trust Rich Rod. I like Rich Rod's. Rich Rod's our future. And people ask questions about Rich Rod and go, you guys are idiots. This guy's taking us to 4 straight bowl games, a Pac-12 South Championship. Relax.
Yeah.
We're going to be okay. But I've been asked before, you know, Coach Smith said this. I've been fortunate to play for 3 great coaches, Larry Smith, Marv Levy, and Chuck Knox. And every one of these coaches, if you all heard it from Larry Smith, play hard and have fun, right? That's why I tell the team, play hard and have fun. Relax. Don't think about things. Just play hard and have fun. If you play hard and have fun, you're going to kick ass. That's what it's about.
I think one of the things that is important to me is you got to care. That's the one thing I don't see a lot of. You got to care that you're representing your family, you're representing your team, you're representing your school, you're representing yourself. And when you go out there and you play like you care, good things happen. But when you're out there going through the motions because you're mad at your coach, because you're not playing enough, so you're going to show him by going half-assed. That just hurts you. That's what I see a lot of things that I don't like out there. You know, I see a lot of going through the motion stuff from a tackling standpoint. Our defensive historically have never allowed this kind of penetration done to them, historically. And this is because they care. If they didn't win, I'm going to show the coach that he needs to play me more by missing tackles. That don't even make any sense.
Jay?
You know, I think Arizona's reputation, regardless of talent or anything else, is that they were always tough teams. We always had tough teams. We got two offensive players at the table and three defensive players. I'm not ashamed to say our reputation when I was in school was that our defense, man, you know what? You came to Arizona, if you left with a win, you were going to leave with a limp, you know, because they were going to beat you up. Mm-hmm. And the same thing for our offense. We were just tough kids. And I think the way I look at Arizona's season this year, right, they're, what, 2-8 right now? Mm-hmm. It's like a bar fight. You're, like, you've been knocked down. You're on your knees, and there's people kicking you and stomping on you. And the guy that wins that fight, the guy that wins that bar fight is the one that reaches up and grabs an ashtray off the table and smashes it against someone's head and splits their head to the white meat. That's how you win those games, right? And that has historically been Arizona. It's a bar fight. You're down. They're on their knees, man. Their nose is bleeding. They got teeth knocked out.
I believe Glenn Perkins, if he did not get his knee blown out, was probably our greatest hitting linebacker of all time. And, of course, Ricky and other guys, Chuck Cecil, but I really believe in, you know, Byron Evans. I still believe Byron Evans, I love Ricky to death, he's my brother, my friend. I still believe Byron Evans is like the most underrated linebacker of all time in U of A history.
And I agree with you. And here's something else a lot of people should take note of. Our special teams, we had three or four guys that played in the NFL.
Starters.
That played nothing but special teams because at the U of A, I think they called it the Raider Squad.
The Raider Squad.
You were dying to be on that. You were dying to be on the punt block team. You were dying to be on the kickoff team. Am I lying, guys?
And
you wanted to play. As big as I was, I wanted to be on the special team. I just wasn't.
Julius, can I say one thing, too? We've all missed out on one guy who's one of the greatest defensive backs in U of A history, Randy Robbins.
Oh, yeah.
We haven't brought up Randy Robbins.
Great cover corner. Never got scored.
Randy Robbins is ahead of his era. He's a 6'2", 6'3", corner, which now the NFL wants, right? Richard Sherman. Mm-hmm. You look at all the NFL teams. That was Randy Robbins in college.
He put a lick on you, too.
And Randy would put a lick on you. Randy Robbins might be the most – I might have made a mistake by saying Byron Evans most underrated. Randy Robbins is probably the most underrated U of A football player of all time.
He was a
shutdown
corner.
Yeah, he played 11 years in the NFL, right?
Yeah, he did.
Shutdown corner. Safety.
I would say Chuck was a hard hit. Let me tell you, he would knock you. He would knock your head off.
Yeah. You know, like Chuck didn't give a shit.
Yeah,
but you know what? He studied the game though. He wasn't very fast, but he knew where you were going to be. You know, before you did. So that's and he was coming downhill. He you know, he was hard hitting.
Isn't it fun about talking about great defenses?
Oh yeah, because
I wish we had one
special team and defense.
I think we're about ready to say the same thing. There's a guy we all played with him, right? If you're not a longtime diehard Arizona fan, you might not remember this name. There's a kid named Gordon Bunch. Right, the dude had no nerve endings in his body, man, and he didn't care if it was a game. He didn't care if it was practice. He didn't care if it was Friday afternoon when you were in shorts and t-shirts. He was coming to lay you out. That dude, he was like not. Yeah, he was a great hitter, but he was nuts. He was nuts.
I think one of the things that we haven't touched on very much is that our offenses were pretty damn good as well. You know, all this. I understand, but it may be linebacker you, but it's linebacker you and running back too.
There you go.
16 points a game was good. 16 points a game was good.
When they only score 14.
I'm going to tell y'all a quick story about Gordon Bunch. I think I was a graduate assistant that year. We were at practice, and, you know, Vance, he's one of our star athletes. And I never forget, Gordon hit Vance so hard. This is a true story. And I think Miss Smith, if she's listening, she'll tell it. He hit Vance so hard, Coach Smith went up to Gordon and said, if you ever do that again, I'm going to put you on a bus and send you home. We flew you here, but we're going to make you fly. Bunch didn't care. And Bunch said that. Bunch said, I did not come here to sit and watch somebody play. I came here to play, and I don't care who he is. And he continued to practice that way again.
Now, how much of that was because Vance was like a delicate little flower, though, that could not be touched, and he was like our freaking... He was our beauty queen, right? Yeah, you know what? I'll tell you what.
Yeah, he was Gordon a franchise Bunch
knocked
player.
My dick in the dirt like that, Coach Smith would have given him a high five.
Yeah.
Well, let me tell you. Let me tell you what really happened. Majority of that, Vance was talking trash to Good Bunch all game. Talking about he's too fast to get hit. You couldn't hit me if you wanted to. Because Vance kept, Gordon kept running up, just scoring by him. And Vance says, no, you didn't have him, man. You couldn't have him. So Gordon lit him up. Vance laid on the ground. And an hour and a half after practice, I go in the training room. Vance is laying on the trainer table, talking about, man, I didn't even see him coming, man. I said, Vance, he hit you straight on. How did you not see him? He said, I don't know, D, but he that was wrong. it was an exciting day because Vance was temporarily in my position at that time when they were having some mental problems on the coaching staff. But it was a very interesting day. Very interesting day.
You know, that's, I mean, David, he's not shy about David, right? He never has been, and that's things. Some things never change, man. And he's like, and that's why we love him, right? But I'll tell you what, Vance Johnson was NCAA champion in the long jump, yes, as a freshman. He was the fastest guy in the 1985 draft, and this dude took his job, right? And I'm telling you what, Vance, I mean, the dude was legit, man. He could play football, and this cat took his job. So what does that say?
Exactly.
What it says is I predicted it in high school.
when you played him at Choya, right?
David ran hard. We used to go against him in practice, and he ran hard. People don't give him that credit. David ran hard. He just wasn't a finesse runner. He was a hard runner, and that's what made him so good. He ran very hard.
Yes, so David enjoyed contact too. So,
well, you know, the thing about it was you had to prove a point. If you just was finesse all the time, they play you for that. So you got to hit them once or twice and let them know that you weren't afraid of it. Sure. And that was the key.
And you know, one of the things that I'm hoping for this weekend is I'm hoping all the fans show up to the game, and I'm hoping they stay through the game. You know, them young kids is out there playing right now. They need that support. They need every fan in Tucson to go buy a ticket, show up at the game, and be supportive, and stay.
You know, that's the key. You got to stay
because you never know what might happen. You know, you walk out of the game and thinking we're losing, and all of a sudden you hear a big old roar. Guess what? You can't get back in unless you pay.
And how many times has that happened in the ASU series?
A lot.
A lot of times it comes down to that last possession.
So I would advise anybody and anyone that has never been to an ASU U of A game, go buy your ticket. Go get your ticket. Like T.O. say, get your popcorn. They're going to be selling a lot of popcorn Saturday night. Mm-hmm. And you need to get some. Because the kids going to bring it. That's a game you don't need nobody to have a conversation with. You don't need no motivational speech. That's a game that you show up and you know when I walk on the field at night, this is it. And for some of them seniors, it's the last time you're going to get the chance to knock these dudes upside their head. Mm-hmm. So you need to play football, period.
Or just to play football, period.
Yeah. You know, because some of these guys' careers are over after Saturday.
All right, so the next question. Sean, do you have the questions?
Yeah, I do have the questions here. So we have a couple more. The first one is going to be, aside from playing at home at Arizona Stadium, what's your next favorite place to play?
I personally, and this is not because it's the game, I love the ASU Stadium. I played in that in high school one time. I like playing there. And it was a bonus that we won there every time we
right.
went too. But I like it. And I also like playing in the Rose Bowl. That was really nice.
Yeah, that's a big stadium. It's 100,000.
Huge stadium. And it's just... when you play in those historical type places,
right?
The Coliseum and things like that. That's what Moon Green.
Now, what do you think the loudest stadium is? I've heard Washington. I've heard different stadiums. What's the loudest stadium?
I can tell you what I think was the loudest stadium.
Give him the mic, dude.
I can tell you what I think was the loudest stadium and the rowdiest stadium was Notre Dame, because they were right on top of you. I mean, it's an old facility, but the fans are like right on top.
2 yards behind you.
I mean,
I believe that holds like 90,000 too. Yeah.
But
back in the day, it was about 65,000.
But yeah. their crowd and the fact that they were that close to you. Normally, you playing games, you don't notice people. At least I didn't. I never noticed people in the stands. But coming and standing on the sideline or coming out of the game, you actually felt them people behind you, you know? And that's why it was so nice to whoop their butt or ass, however you want to call it.
You say whatever you want, Julius, you're good.
I'll tell you what was a trip. In 84, right, we played LSU in Baton Rouge, right? And that is that's a crazy place, right? So we pull up to the stadium, right? And their fans surround our bus, and they're pushing on the bus, and they're rocking the bus back and forth. Tiger meat, tiger meat. And there's, tiger bait, right? And so I'll tell you what, I don't know who said it, but someone inside the bus said, they don't know who the F we are. And we came off that bus, and like Arizona was ready to rumble, was ready to get down and throw down with those LSU fans. Like right outside the bus coming to the stadium, you know. I think that they're used to intimidating people, right? They were used to scaring people. And we're like, man, we don't even know who you are. We don't care about the Southeast Conference. We don't care who you are. We know you got a great program here. It didn't matter.
That's right.
And unfortunately, I missed that because that would have been a great time to play there. But, you know, I'm with Julius. I got two places. You know, I love playing on the road and beating the shit out of somebody on the road. ASU on the road. How do you beat Washington State, Washington on the road? It doesn't matter. When you go win on the road, the best feeling in the world is when you walk out the stadium and you go like this. You hear nothing. Is that the best feeling, guys?
I'll tell you what the question is. You need to ask him on what it's like to beat number one USC in the Coliseum.
Oh, yeah.
But here's my other but Notre Dame, of course, that Notre Dame was great. Because going to that stadium was like, who are you guys? Why are you guys even playing here? As we all know, there's one of our greatest all-time coaches of all time, our linebacker coach, Tom Rogerman. Halftime speech. We're down 10-0 halftime. And Tom Rogerman was our emotional leader of our coaching staff, outside Coach Smith. And Rogie was from South Bend. And we were like down 10-0. We didn't play very well, but we're still in the game. Tables, water gates, chairs are flying. He was embarrassed to be part of U of A football because he goes, we're better than they are. What are you guys thinking? Why are you intimidated? And then we came out, beat him 13-10 afterwards, right? Max's big kick. There's a lot of big plays before that. You know, it was the Phil Freemans of the world, the great Greg Turners of the world. We won't get into Max wanting to quit at halftime. He goes, I'm done. I'm quitting.
Paul Horning, and Max hits that field goal, and this school that they had zero respect for, Arizona, right? You could have heard a pin drop in that place. The only thing you could hear was this little pocket, little square of Arizona fans that made the trip, and they were going absolutely nuts.
You know, the thing that was so weird, it wasn't that Max wanted to quit. Max was upset because we didn't let him kick a field goal before halftime.
Absolutely.
Because he said we'd have made it. He would have made the field goal. And it's interesting. And
he would too, probably.
The game. But he wanted to kick it during the course of the game before half. He was really upset that we didn't allow him to do that.
But on top of, you know, for me, I grew up in Wisconsin. So for me, I had like family, high school coaches. It was really cool. Like, you know, anybody who plays, you go with your families, that was really cool. But the other greatest place for me to play, you know, people don't realize, they said, you know, our first place we ever played at UCLA's first year was 1982 playing in the Rose Bowl. And for us walking the Rose Bowl, I mean, that was pretty cool. I was like, wow, this is the freaking Rose Bowl. 1982, when UCLA moved there from the Coliseum. We've all played in the Coliseum. We've all played at all these great stadiums. We've all played in a lot of us played
college, NFL, a lot of, you know, USFL, Canadian. We all played a lot of great teams. Walking the Rose Bowl for the first time ever in 1982 was pretty amazing. It was like, holy shit, this is the Rose Bowl.
We're going to get into a couple more questions now.
Yes, okay. We have two that we definitely want to get to before we're, because we're going to be done here in about 15, 20 minutes. The next question is, how has playing for the U of A prepared you for life after college?
I remember we had a slogan in the locker room under Coach Smith. He said, you know, those who stay will be champions. And it didn't necessarily mean only on the football field.
Right.
It meant in life. You know, staying, if you stay here, if you stay, you'll be a champion. You know, we was hoping it would be on the football field, but it meant more than that. It meant in the classroom. It meant in life. So it's definitely helped us, at least me, and I know the rest of these guys here, just persevere through great things in our lives and just hang in there.
Well, I can tell you this much. I'm glad I came to Arizona. I really am, because growing up in the inner cities of Washington, D.C., you know, losing my parents when I was in the fifth grade, you know, 30 days apart, you know, and getting an opportunity to come and get a scholarship. I never forget Coach Smith telling my stepdad at that time, he said, if your son comes to Arizona and does everything that he's supposed to do, I promise you I'll see to it that he graduates. And I can honestly say Coach Smith stuck to that. I've got my bachelor's degree in business and public administration. I also have a master's degree from the U of A. So, and the people in Tucson have been very supportive. I mean, I've never had an issue. You know, people here, they seem to love the guys to stick around and the guys to stay. I give back a lot to the community. Coach Smith just taught us how to be men, you know, and how to make a commitment to something that has given you a lot. I think that's what happened, because I'm looking at the guys that's sitting at this table, and we do a lot of different things that people don't even know about. Speaking engagements, going and visiting kids. I've had Jay come and speak at my school.
I have no doubt in my mind, right? No doubt in my mind. Anybody at this table would step in front of a bullet for me. You know,
absolutely.
35 years later, right? 35 years later, these guys would step in front of a bullet for me, and I would do that for them. How do you, like, you can't invent that. How do you create that? How do you, you can't train someone to do that. You can't make somebody do that. It's the love that we have for each other. Maybe being the underdog, maybe being underachievers, maybe being the kids that didn't end up at Notre Dame or USC or Ohio State or Alabama. Maybe that is the common bond. But when people say, like, hey, man, we're going to ride or die together, I mean, these cats mean it. They mean it. And 35, 40 years later, it's still the truth.
Exactly. It's totally irreplaceable with the bond you guys have with each other. David, do you want to
say? Yeah, I think for me, it was nice to prove myself right for what I was saying in front of my family and friends. Nobody in America wakes up and says, you know what we need? We need a 5'6", 170-pound running back to lead us to the championship. No.
Barry Sanders was pretty good, wasn't he? David, Barry Sanders was pretty good.
He was 5'8", 203. That's why, that's why this is my story. Can I talk, Jew? Okay. So to be able to prove myself right,
it's rough,
when all these people were saying, you can't. And Jerry, he was there at Sunnyside when the teachers would say, are you serious? You really think you're going to get a scholarship? He was there. He saw it. He heard it. And to be able to do that in front of your the people you grew up with has helped me to the point to where I really don't believe that there's nothing that I can't accomplish. And it was that belief that Coach Smith had in me that gave me the opportunity to where I can have friends like this, to where if we need something, we're there for each other. And there's nothing outside of being in the military that can reproduce that. Only team sports. And by basketball, there's only 15 people. It may be the same, but when you got 100 people and all of them live for each other, it can't be beat.
Exactly.
Well, this is what I went back to earlier on. You know, what do you miss about playing football? Game day in the locker room. It's all your brotherhood, your friendships. I miss the locker room more than anything in the world. Don't all we?
More than anything. But the games were great, but we had such a good time in the locker room.
And we can't repeat a lot of things we did in the locker room, how we talked about what we did.
Well, we can because I'm a porn star. But besides that.
Okay. Thank God's getting deep now.
Well,
no, but let me get. Let me.
Only on Tuesdays and Thursdays.
I can confirm.
Only Tuesdays and Thursdays, but the rest of the week I was a choir boy. But I'm just saying that it's amazing.
You never replace that. But there's two things that were just said here that I really respect. First of all, Jay Dobyns. Jay, none of us ever stood in front of a bullet but you. So God bless you and thank you for what you've done for our country and yourself. No one's ever done this. So we don't know what it's like. Maybe Julius growing up in... Julius grew up in D.C. You might have shot in front of a bullet.
I think John is correct. I mean,
no, but I mean that. I mean that, J-Dob, from my heart. I mean, there's nobody stood in front of a bullet. We love J-Dob. He served his country in a great, wonderful way. And also, Coach Smith. When Coach Smith was dying, I called him, and I mean, he's a great man, a great person. When he was dying, I told him, you know, Coach Smith, I took a risk on you the rest of my life, because we're going back on how it affected our life. Mm-hmm. I go, Coach Smith, Larry, you're my second father. I came to U of A because you're my father. I came from Wisconsin. I came from a town of 300 people. I mean, that's a big city back in Wisconsin.
I couldn't even pronounce the name when I looked it up.
Yeah, well, my hospital was Oconomowoc, North Lake. But I grew up in a town of 300 people, 7 bars. So that's Wisconsin. and you wonder why I drink sometimes.
A lot of sense now, doesn't it?
Yeah. Thank you. Come full circle.
I would say Larry Smith was our father. I don't care if you liked him, didn't like him. He loved you and he cared about you. And that's what I remember about our U of A days that, you know, it was a brotherhood. It was a family. Larry Smith is our father. You know, Rogi, Aikney, Coach Allen, all our coaches, Axman. They're our parents. They're our family, and that's how we were treated. And I think that's how we grew up and live. And I hope today's athletes get that feeling nowadays. It's not about them. It's about the University of Arizona. It's not about me making a big play. It's about Tucson, Arizona, and U of A kicking ass over ASU.
And you know something else, when I look back at how Coach Smith took us through practice, I don't remember a lot of yelling and screaming, you know.
Pounding your chest.
I don't remember Coach Smith and them doing a lot of that, you know.
I'm joking.
But I will say this though, Coach Smith took a chance on a lot of guys. I mean, if you go back and look at the roster of some of the kids that he took from the inner cities, especially from the inner cities like D.C., New York, New Jersey, Chicago. I mean, he went and he sent his guys into some places that I'm like, do you know where you are? Especially when they came to recruit me. I'm like, you know what time? First of all, you know what time it is. You shouldn't be here after dark. And the man came to my house. And like I said earlier, you know, he made a promise to my dad, my stepdad at the time, that if your kid is doing what he's supposed to do, I'm going to be there for him. So, you know, Coach Smith was very special to me. I mean, I never forget, he sent me a plaque after I got my master's degree when we beat USC. Yep. He had it laminated. And he's at Missouri, you know, and I'm like, I get this thing in the mail. This is from him. You know, which I,
you know, Larry Smith loved overachievers, man. He loved overachievers.
Yeah.
We got a 5'6" running back here, local kid, right? Who turns out to be one of the greatest players in history. We got an undersized linebacker, right? Who turns out to be a guy who will literally take your head off, right? Split your helmet in half with bees, right? Got a couple of junior college guys, right?
Style football, speed outside back of the.
You got a couple of JC guys, right? If you went to a JC. That means, like, your first pass, someone didn't think you were good enough, right? Took a chance on these guys. Turned out to be the greatest guys. I'll tell you what, I went to the University of Arkansas for a year. Coach, I played for Lou Holtz. Holtz is barking at my roommate, right? Running him down, calling him names. And I turned to Coach Holtz. I've never been good at much of anything other than standing up to a bully, right? Coach Holtz is bullying my roommate, calling him names. And I said, just trying to take the heat off my friend, I said, Coach, what do you call me? He turned to me and he said, son, I call you a recruiting mistake. And you know what? Larry Smith took a chance on that recruiting mistake. Larry Smith took a chance on a guy that Lou Holt said was a recruiting mistake, right?
And another receiver, Brad Anderson, was a recruiting mistake.
Brad Anderson started at BYU.
Yeah.
We had people.
For the Bears.
We had this group of guys, right, when I was in school that didn't make sense. None of the puzzle pieces fit. Everybody was different. Everybody was under. They were all these underachievers and people didn't fit. And he figured out how to bring it together. Yeah. And I tell you what, man, when I was in school. And you guys know this. You would not want to walk down a dark alley and run into the freaking dudes that we played football with, man. They were some bad boys. And they're like not only bad boys on the football field, off the field, these guys were some rough boys now, right? These are some rough boys. You want to go out and have a beer, right? You better be toeing the line around these dudes, man, because you will get knocked the fuck out around some of these dudes, man.
J-Dub. We all had each other's back, didn't we?
No doubt.
That's what
no
about.
Doubt.
We all had each other's back.
That's what I said earlier, too.
Family takes care of family.
You got all this stuff going on in this country, right? You got all the, like, black, white issues, all the race issues. And you got three black dudes and two white guys sitting here and 100 more of us that played together that are straight brothers, man. And no one cares. No one cares. Everybody's got different opinions, different views. When it comes to us, no one cares.
And that's the way it should be.
Absolutely.
What was your last? You had one more question?
We did have one more question. The last question I had. No. The last question is, and it's good because we're got about 10 minutes left here. The last question was, if you keep track of some of the local kids that are about to go to the U of A, do you see any local talent through the high schools that could make some noise for the U of A and beyond?
Hey, I know a little kid that's 8 years old that lives down in Sarita, Arizona. His name's RJ, and this kid. He has his own monogram, RJ3. Go look him up on YouTube. That's the next thing coming to Arizona.
Where's he going to high school?
I don't know where he's going to go to high school, but he's 8 years old.
Where's he live?
In Sarita. The kid is unbelievable. He's a phenom.
Is he
a
video?
Is he a
young David Adams? I'll show you the video. He's got some skills. He really does.
You know, I don't know. I don't follow high school football as close as I would like, but I do know that there is a lot of talent here that gets overlooked because they say, oh, this is Tucson football. When I was a junior in high school, I ran into Julius, and he thought it was so cute that we played with rubber footballs. And I was telling him, I said, you know, I'll be up there with you soon, and we'll see how cute this shit is.
You can't make that shit up.
I'll tell you what.
Yeah. I've never seen anything like that. No, because everybody plays with leather, and now everybody plays. But those are just things that people, there's not a lot of respect for Arizona football. You know, everybody thinks you got to go to California and get somebody, Texas, Florida, all these other places. But there's a lot of talent here if given the opportunity. And that's the key. Okay.
Join
I'll tell you what. You look at these kids, right?
Joining from San Diego?
The talent that came out of Tucson, right? Right now, you got Julius' son, Justin Holt, right? I'm just telling you, just watch, because Justin's got a lot of his dad in him, right? He's going to show up, and he's going to surprise you, right? You got Cam Denson there, right?
Yeah.
Cam, he's coming. I'm telling you, don't underestimate that kid. He's coming. You got Trevor Wood. Trevor's going to be a senior next year. He's a junior this year. Trevor's going to be a senior next year. We played with Trevor's dad.
Yeah.
Dave Wood was a defensive lineman for us. He's a legacy. Carter Wood was a center before Trevor got there. It's a legacy. The kid can play football now, yeah. Right? There's talent in this town. There's talent in this state. If I'm not going to flatter myself to tell Rich Rod how to recruit or how his staff how to recruit, all I would do was, like, fold my hands and say, man, don't ignore these kids here. Don't ignore these kids in this city and this state, because there's football players here that can help this team.
That's the difference. They're football players. You know, a lot of people don't understand. You know, you got athletes, but there's really, really people that can play football, mm-hmm. And that's what they're not seeing.
Yeah, you just can't let these kids, like you said, Jay, leave the state. You got to keep them here. You got to keep them in Tucson. You can't let them go somewhere else and become these mega stars. Which can happen with some of these kids. You do have talent here. We just have to keep them here at the U of A.
You got to make them want to stay here. There is nothing like playing in your hometown. Mm-hmm. There's nothing like it. For several reasons. One, no matter what you do, it's really blowing out of proportion. You know, you gain 1,000 yards, they all of a sudden, you know he got 1,800 yards, don't you? And you only got 1,000.
That's right.
Well, that's David Adams talking once again. That's
right. And the best part about being a local kid, right? So you like you're friends with David, right?
Right.
So David's like, all right, he comes up. Everybody loves David. He's a football star. He's this common man who overachieves and gets greatness, right? Everybody loves David. It's good to be David's friend, right? Because all the girls know David. We're in school. All the girls know David. Like, and I'm talking like, right? He's a charming dude, right? And he's a funny guy. And he's like. I'm not talking just the black girls, the Mexican girls, the white girls, the Asian girls all know David. So when you're friends with David, it's good to be friends with David.
I'm an intergalactic lover. I sleep with women from other planets.
Hey, we can't argue that.
I just want you to know. I've gone to other planets. Right there. I've gone to other planets.
David, I just hung out with you for the leftovers.
That's right. One of the things that
I didn't like David all that much, but there were so many girls around him. I'm like, he's my friend. He's my friend. Yeah, I block for him.
And I'm a team player. I'm willing to share.
I refuse to tackle him in practice that I want to get him hurt.
That's right.
And I appreciate that.
That's right. Going back to the local talent, we had Jeff Cotton of.
Let's talk about the local talent.
Yeah. So we had Pima football on. We had Jeff Cotton, who's out of Mountain View. Now, he had to go the JC route because of grades. It wasn't because, it was a recruiting mistake or he didn't have what it takes to play D1 football. So I wish that Rodriguez would actually look at the kid because he's got Jay Dobyns' hands. I mean, you get a fingernail on if the kid catches it. So if you guys ever get a chance, you put a good word in for Jeff Cotton from Pima College.
Can I talk about the JC route?
Sir.
I'm a guy, I mean, to be honest, small town Wisconsin. Wisconsin wanted me to walk on. San Diego State wanted me to walk on. It was the era where it changed from, 110 scholarships to 95, whatever became that year. I'm telling these local kids, and I've talked to kids, I went the junior college route. Mine wasn't academic because apparently I got overlooked. Maybe the coaches didn't think I was good enough. For me, they said I had skinny legs. They didn't think I was going to get bigger. I was an all-state high school player. But junior college route is an amazing way of going and great opportunities. And what you do as a junior college player is you get to play 2 years and hopefully start. I mean, I went to one of the best junior colleges in California. We were ranked like third in the nation. College of Sequoia is just in Visalia, California. And what happened, I became a first-team All-American, junior college, and all of a sudden, like, Wisconsin, who wanted me to walk on, is all of a sudden, like, they're recruiting me heavily. All these schools that wanted me to walk on recruited me heavily, but I picked Arizona because of Coach Smith. I mean, that's why I went to U of A, Coach Smith. And that's,
Coach Smith has got to be one of the greatest
coaches. Yeah, I mean, it's because of, and as a junior college player, there's two things you look at. Where can I start?
Right.
You got 2 years. A lot of these guys go, well, I want to go to USC. I go, why? To be a backup?
To sit on the bench.
You got 2 years to start. That's all you got, start. And I was fortunate enough, I came to U of A because Coach Smith, and I had 2 years of starting here. But the idea is a junior college, it's a great way to go if you're overlooked, if it's academics, whatever it is. And then you can step in the door and play for 2 years. It's an amazing way to go. And a lot of kids overlook that. Mm-hmm. And junior college was my greatest way of going that I could ever thought of.
And a lot
I got blessed.
And a lot of our viewers, they're not as old as me or some of the other guys. Coach Smith came into a mess because Coach Mason left this, left the school on sanctions. He had it was a big slush fund thing, and in the late 70s we were just going into the Pac-10. We were brand new members of the Pac-10. Some of the schools didn't want us. I know they didn't want ASU, and the only reason ASU even got into the pack is because we wouldn't go without them. So
you know. Look at the JC route. Like you, like Julius here, turns out to be like a staple, a stalwart in our defense in a like not some poo butt conference either. Mm-mm. The Pac-10 at the time, the most dynamic football conference in the country.
Yes.
At that time of year, right? John Kaiser shows up, right? Oh, a JC guy. I'd never seen anybody, personally, I'd never seen anybody bench 450 pounds before. I'd never personally witnessed it. And I'm like,
that wasn't me either.
How did this guy slip through the cracks? How did this guy slip through the cracks? How does this guy, how can a guy that's that strong and that's good not start at a D1 school? You know, because not they don't always see you, man. They don't always see you.
Tell me about it.
And you know what?
Different era, different time.
Like John talks about the junior college route. The difference between him and I was recruited pretty heavily out of high school by a lot of good schools, Pittsburgh, Michigan State, Indiana, Iowa. But, you know, growing up in inner cities, school wasn't something that was a number one priority for me, so I didn't have the grades. So I was what they call a non-predictor back then. So I had to go to a junior college. But I went to the number one junior college in the country at that time, which was called, I don't know about that. But they had just played in the junior college Rose Bowl a couple of years prior to me getting there, Ellsworth Community College. And I'm telling you, we had guys that were like grown men. You know, I'm 17 years old, and I'm like, some of these guys are coming to our, to the JC that I'm at, that have been at Ohio State and flunked out, and they've come to this program. So, you know, my goal was to go there and play. Like John said, I didn't go to JC not to play. I went there to start because I knew how important that was as far as getting recruited all over again. The junior college route is not a bad route to go.
No, not at all.
You know, you can work on your academics. You can work on your self-esteem. You can find out what you really made of. Because if you can't make it there, trust me, it ain't going to happen.
Right, and you're going to play. I mean, you know, you're not going to be a freshman. You're not going to redshirt. You're going to play right away. So that has a lot to do with it as well.
All right. Well, I'm going to open it up to questions one last time here. So if you guys have any questions for the guys, we're gonna run down the sponsors one more time, and then we'll wrap things up here. So, again, thank you so much for zPizza and Tap Room for hosting. They're here at Locking Down on Naranja, a great place to enjoy great pizza, great beer. Chris Lawler, Nova Home Loans, thank you so much for sponsoring us here. Surreal Skin by Sharon, Classic Cuts, Oasis Air Conditioning and Heating, and Michas. Thank you all so much for being our sponsors here. And
the next remote we will have at zPizza, which we like to tell you guys now, is home of 520 Sports Talk, will be December 13th. We'll be having Coach Peabody and the Pima College men's basketball team here. So you want to make sure
yes. You
come out for that show. Once again, if you can't come out live and watch it, please tune into the Facebook page, 520 Sports. The nice thing about that is if you've got earlier commitments or something like that, it keeps you from watching the show live. It does embed itself onto the page, and you can watch it at your convenience anytime throughout, at your convenience. We still have all the old shows on there, too. So if you're a new viewer to 520 Sports Talk, go ahead and check out the older shows. We've had some great guests on for the last 3 months, and I'm sure you'll enjoy it.
Yes, thank you. And producer Andy, coming through in the clutch. He reminds us about Tucson A-List. And now our new theme music starting next week.
Because of the fact. I believe it's
seventh.
Yeah, at the Rock, you want to go see them. They're a great band, local talent. Once again, that's what 520 is all about. Is anything in 520, we want to go ahead and promote you, and we appreciate your viewership.
Gotcha. All right. Well, thank you guys so much. Any last words? Anything you guys want to say to the crowd that's watching here?
Bear down, baby.
Bear down. Start a new streak.
Exactly.
I agree with that.
All right,
it all
guys.
Starts with belief. You got to believe.
Well, I mean, I hopefully would be speaking for everyone here when I think that I would love nothing more as a graduate of UA myself to watch them come down here and lose bowl eligibility to a team that has basically underachieved for the better part of the year due to injuries, due to whatever it is. I would love them to come down here and just get their asses completely handed to them and send them crying.
Hey, guys, what's our theory every year when we play SU? Beat the shit out of ASU.
That's what he's saying. It's not beat bear down Arizona. It's beat the shit out of ASU. That's what you want.
Yeah.
That's right. You couldn't have said it better.
All right. Wonderful. Well, for David, Jerry, Bill, Julius, Jay, John, I am Sean. Thank you so much. And producer Andy, Jason, Caleb, Liam, Rob, Bob, Michelle, everyone here. Everyone here making the Wildcat. Thank you guys so much for joining us on 520 Sports Talk. We will see you next week. We'll be right back.